I always enjoy talking to our next guest, who is well on his way to supplanting Howard Stern as the king of all media. Nathan J. Robinson is the publisher and editor-in-chief of the magazine Current Affairs. Current Affairs also publishes books, and we're going to talk about their new book, and they have a podcast as well. Nathan has been writing a lot of great stuff and publishing a lot of great stuff, so we have a lot to talk about, starting with the new book, which is entitled, let me make sure I get it right, I think it's called The Current Affairs Rules for Life. So Nathan, first of all, welcome.
Yes. Secondly, thank you. So nice to be back with you.
Yeah, lovely to have you. Now, that rules for life, it rings a bell with me. Help me out.
Yeah, it's a familiar title. Well, you know, Jordan Peterson, Canadian psychologist, released his best-selling 12 Rules for Life earlier this year, and he sold millions of copies. So we thought, well, and his rules for life are insipid and useless. So we thought, if he can sell rules for life, we have a lot of rules for life. So we have the Current Affairs Rules for Life, which are our own deconstruction of Peterson's philosophy and a little bit of advice for people as well on how to live better lives than the lives they would live by following Jordan Peterson's 12 Rules for Life.
Now, Jordan Peterson, he is the well-known Canadian psychologist and crustacean buff, if I'm not mistaken. Yes. He's a guy who thinks we should model our social order on the behavior of lobsters, is he not?
Yes, and you can see on the cover here, we have our evolution chart in which we depict the human species steadily evolving into a noble arthropod.
So what's that old supposedly Egyptian story about what animal crawls in the morning and walks in the afternoon and then walks on three legs?
Oh, yeah.
You remember that? And then scuttles the ocean floor on claws in its old age.
The scuttling phase.
Right. Okay. So without further ado, Current Affairs Rules for Life. Is it subtitle I see here is on social justice and its critics, or you could have said its discontents, I suppose. So is it just about Jordan Peterson, or is it about other...
No, it reproduces essays that we have published over the course of the past year about a number of different people on the right who have been critical of social justice and the left. And we want to kind of... we've become known a little bit for these kind of these scathing... some people call them takedowns. They're not quite takedowns because we're very fair-minded. But we've been sort of going through very systematically the critiques that are made of the left and seeing where they're right and where, for the most part, they're completely wrong. So this book collects a number of those. There are 9 or 10 of those in here. And then it also has some other essays defending basic left principles and some rules for life.
So takedowns, you guys have done a lot of great takedowns, you in particular, but your other writers as well. Here's the thing I was pondering as I was thinking about your book and thinking about takedowns, because there was a phase in my life when I wrote a bunch of takedowns of wrote two about Thomas Friedman and, you know, a few other people as well, Daniel Loeb, the investment banker, and some other people. And I went through this phase, this cyclical process, and it was, I really get energized writing these takedowns. Then I thought, I should feel bad that I'm basically turning into a takedown artist.
Right.
Then I wanted to, but I don't.
but you don't feel bad?
I don't. And I don't know what that says about me, but do you feel bad about?
Good. I still feel bad. Which I think you should. I think you should feel bad.
All right, okay.
No. I have very mixed feelings. On the one hand, I really don't like... I also don't like just being a critic. I don't like... I try... Which is why... one of the things I do try and do towards the end of this book is provide a little bit of a starting window into a humane and optimistic left alternative, and I'm very big on that.
Yeah.
Because I think it's not bad to go and dismantle somebody at length. I think it's actually very important. People have been asking us for a long time to address Sam Harris's writings. Have an original piece in this book, which goes through and explains why I think a lot of the things that he says are sort of pseudo-rational rather than rational. And I think that's actually very important for helping people understand why certain people are wrong. But I also don't want to be just crabby. I think it doesn't give people anything. So I think as long as at the end, at the end of the Peterson piece we did, I talk about how important it is to give people something. People seek Peterson out because he gives them a sense of meaning, because he gives them rules, because he gives them guidance in a very hopeless and uncertain world, and why I think the left needs to do a better job of doing that for people and sort of filling the gap that he stepped in to fill.
Yeah, and I think that's great, and I think that's fine. And by the way, one of my early, I used to be, I don't know if I still am, in Sam Harris's Wikipedia page. I was his first critic, I think, back when he first came out. But your takedown of him was excellent and involved a lot more detailed reading of Sam Harris, frankly, than I think I could bring myself to do. My contribution was coining the term evangelical atheist, but
I think that's so true though with him, and it's very interesting actually because he adopts so many of the methods characteristic. So much of like the fervor and the viciousness towards dissent, and it's interesting because he uses the language of rationalism, but the style of dogma, and he's so vicious and hostile towards all of his critics that I think that's a very accurate descriptor.
And he's also talked about nuclear bomb attacks against all the world's Muslim cities.
Yeah.
He's advocated torture, although he kind of tries to disclaim that now. And I have to admit, I haven't stayed current with Harris. I had enough. And he inspires the same kind of fervent followers who would track me down when I first started writing about him in 2005, 2006, and send me emails about, what I must want, the sorts of sexual acts that I must want Jesus to perform on me and that type of thing.
Okay.
So he really inspires the same kind of fanatical fervor. And Dawkins, Richard Dawkins, perhaps slightly less so, but Dawkins seems to me just kind of the old school racist Oxford Don who, just thinks the natives are getting restless and doesn't know what to do about it, but also coaches it in a veneer of rationality while talking about totally irrational things like the idea of the existence of something called memes that, to me, as far as I can tell, are angels for atheists. They're the pseudoscientific version of intermediaries between the physical and the intangible world. I don't know, but what's your take on Dawkins?
Well, yeah, and there's a common element that I talk about, and in fact, there are a couple of points that I make. These essays are written separately, but they all sort of have a thread in common, which is that with a lot of these critics, they embody the very tendency that they denounce the left for, which is supposedly the failure to listen, the failure to reason, the failure to think critically. These are all the things that they say this crazy social justice left does. And of course, there are those tendencies on the left. And I'm very critical of parts of the left that I think are not self-critical enough. But it's so interesting when you read these guys and they're all denouncing the failure to listen without listening. They're so they're so anti-unreasonable people without displaying any empathy or without being fair to the other side's arguments. And you think, well, that's the whole thing that you're supposedly defending, this concept of reason and humility, you're displaying absolutely none of. And this is what irritates me so much about people like Steven Pinker and Richard Dawkins and and Sam Harris. It's not that I am anti-enlightenment or anti-reason. I love these things, but I think you have to take them seriously, and they're not just bits of language. And I talk in the book a lot about scientism, and you know, Sam Harris and Steven Pinker hate the phrase scientism. They think it's a boo word. It's a word coined by the left to attack science, but it isn't. What scientism is talking about is the using the rhetoric and the aesthetics of science to cover for things that aren't actually using basic scientific principles and the scientific method.
So I've puzzled over the psychology of these folks. I mean, I think Jordan Peterson, slightly different category, but related. I just think there's something wrong with him, basically. I don't think he, as the old folks used to say, I don't think he's right in the head. But with Harris and Dawkins, And I don't know. I haven't seen Pinker that much. I've actually debated Harris one, but sort of. But was on a panel with him. But I feel as if they don't realize what they're doing. That they genuinely. I could be wrong, but is that your impression also? That they actually think they're being scientific and rational while they're being emotional and big and irrational. Do you think that's true?
I think that's absolutely correct. I begin the Sam Harris essay with an epigraph, and it's from it's actually from a T-shirt. The quote that I begin the thing with is from a T-shirt I saw in the French Quarter, which said, "I'm not arguing. I'm just explaining why I'm right." And I liked that T-shirt because I thought that so captures the attitude that these men have, which is that everyone else is arguing. I'm not arguing. I'm not being I'm not being stubborn. I'm not being unreasonable. That's the other people. What I'm doing is being, I'm completely different, and I'm just telling you why everything you think is correct is not correct, and everything I think is correct. So there's this huge lack of self-awareness. You're right that Jordan Peterson fits in a different category. I mean, I reproduced some of the diagrams that he has in his Maps of Meaning book, which are just full of, like, dragons. he's got a lot of stuff about dragons. Mm-hmm. Which is a very different thing from this kind of pseudo rationality that thinks it's capable of transcending ideology and getting everyone else has opinions. I have facts. I mean, Sam Harris wrote a whole book, The Moral Landscape, which is about how his moral viewpoints are science. He has a science of morality that comes to the morally correct conclusions, whereas everyone else just has ideology.
So, it reminds me of the old cliche of the ugly American who thought anybody in the world could understand English if you just spoke slowly enough. That, there's that vibe to these people.
Or loud. You have to be loud.
Or loud is good, too. So I guess, but there's a part of me that I think after a few rounds with Harris and after trying it in person and so on, it's like, there's a part of me that says, and this is wrong, I'm sure, and I really admired your piece on him, but there's a part of me that says, why bother? I mean, it's like, it is, as my mom used to say, like talking to the wall.
Yes. Yes, I agree. But this is a thing that I think the left mistakes about debate a lot, is we often think, well, why bother? You can't persuade these people. There's no talking to these people. They are not open-minded. They're not going to listen to your perspective. So what could be gotten out of a debate or engaging their arguments? And I think that the mistake, the small mistake there is in thinking that you're trying to convince them rather than in thinking that you're trying to convince their audience. So when I write about Jordan Peterson or Sam Harris, I know that I'm not going to get Sam Harris to go, you're right, I've been very unreasonable. That's just not possible. He's built an entire career on these things now. But what I can do is I can get all of those people who are sending the angry emails, hopefully a few of them will read it and they'll go, you know what, those are some good points. And what I found in writing these kinds of articles is that people respond very well And we get a lot of feedback from people who say, well, I really liked Ben Shapiro's show and nobody had ever told me, nobody had ever gone in detail as to why he was wrong before, but then you did, and I'm persuaded. So it's not that these people are open-minded, it's that hopefully a portion, it only has to be a fraction of their audience. And also, elections are decided by small margins, so you only have to peel off a few open-minded people who are willing to listen as you go through and explain why the things that they think are correct are actually kind of faulty. So that's why I do it. I don't do it to persuade the speakers. I do it to persuade the audience.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So maybe I'll write another takedown. They are fun to write, aren't they? I mean, they are, right?
Sort of, although I just feel I feel so unpleasant at the end.
Yeah.
I mean, I just had to read what I think is the worst book that I've yet read, which is this book, The Diversity Delusion by Heather MacDonald. And it was just so vicious and nasty. And it's, I mean, she says, like, you know, racial stereotypes about black people are justified because of crime rates. It's just so, like, and you know, there's a satisfaction in writing the article, you know, denouncing the thing, but also, like, I want to read a story. I want to read some, I want to read about animals.
I call what you did by reading that book, I call it spelunking in the dark caves of the human spirit. You know, it's just, sometimes it's necessary, but it's, I feel for you. Thank you for doing that. Thank you for taking on that task on behalf of the rest of us.
I don't know what I've been through.
Yeah, I do know, actually. I have a
sense.
You
do? Oh, yes, you do.
Yeah. But now, I read the entire collected works of Tyler Cohen, the economist, which, to be fair, was probably not as unpleasant because he's a bright guy, although deeply misguided. But he thought the Leuven brothers were bluegrass, which is an unacceptable musical error. But
that only you would get exercised.
I was furious, actually. Okay, Nathan J. Robinson, let's do a complete 180.
Oh, let's
talk about your essay of August 31, not so long ago, except in Robinson time, I suppose, entitled The City of Dreams in Defense of the Utopian Impulse. Now that, as they say, is what I'm talking about. This is talking about not just the takedown, but what it means to envision a better world. So what inspired this? You talk about a perfect moment in your opening paragraph.
Yeah, well, I begin by talking about, you know, I live in the French Quarter of New Orleans, and it's just, you know, the part of the neighborhood I live in is just idyllic, and I have a nice balcony, and I get to sit on the balcony, sipping coffee, reading a cookbook, and eating a muffin sometimes, and there's a guy who plays the saxophone down on the corner, and you have it kind of wafting up in the sunshine, and it's just a lovely moment. And, you know, when I think about those, when I experience those kind of moments, I think how easy it would be to give everybody, you know, a good life, because the ingredients of perfect moments are pretty simple. You don't need much to have a very rich and fulfilling life. And that's one of the reasons it's so scandalous that we can't even guarantee people the basics of health and food and shelter. Because they are such simple things to provide. And so I was thinking about, you know, the importance of dreaming, of the importance of taking those perfect moments and coming up with a vision, a beautiful vision of a world that could be. And then I started thinking about, well, there was a time when people did this. I mean, a lot of socialism has been in the sort of Marxist scientific socialism tradition, but utopian socialism has a wonderful grand tradition. And in fact, kind of startlingly rich. I mean, Edward Bellamy's Looking Backward.
Right.
Well, was a bestseller in the 19th century. I mean, it was like the top of the bestseller list. This is a utopian novel that envisages Boston, 100 years from in the year 2000 or whatever. And envisages a world in which all material needs are provided for. And people were so captivated by this. And Bellamy clubs popped up around the country. And there were lots of response novels that were also utopian novels. And people, and it's weird, there were Fourierist movements. There were, you know, Owenite sects.
Right.
There were there were people really were drawn to these ideas that you could pretty easily, and in the world that we live in, change things quite radically. And so I was thinking about that impulse and that history, and trying to revive it a little tiny bit.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I read a lot in college about the, you know, these various in America, the, you know, the Owenite and the other, the utopian communes that proliferated for a while in the United States, and of course you had Charles Fourier in France and so on. But certain elements of that, the idea that you could build a society not just along one axis. Economic, for example, but along multiple axes of male-female relations or gender relations, sexual relations, of other forms of social equality. You know, it's not as if utopian ideals have never made their way into the mainstream. They have.
Right. I
mean, so, and that's worth reflecting on, too, that, for example, feminism, when it came up in the 1960s, was as idealistic a movement as I think has existed in contemporary life, and yet it's now, though still being resisted and challenged in many ways, is now part of the mainstream. So people who say, you know, utopian is used as a pejorative, and I think that's why you wanted to write in defense of it. People think, well, you're being utopian, you're not being practical, but that's not really a contradiction that exists, is it?
No, I don't think it has to be. And I've written about this in the context of prisons and prison abolition. I have an essay called "Can Prison Abolition Ever Be Pragmatic?" where I talk about how you can combine the vision that says, well, ultimately we'd like a world without prisons because we ultimately like a world without any crime, with a pragmatic impulse that says, well, we're not talking about just sort of opening the doors and letting everyone go. What we're talking about is thinking about how do you move steadily towards that world in which you don't have the necessity to have prisons. And I think those kind of imaginative exercises are really important in driving you forward, and they actually help. You know, there's a lot of warnings about utopias. Karl Popper has in The Open Society suggested the utopian impulse has led to a lot of dictatorship. I think that's false. I don't think it has to. If you do qualify it with some pragmatism and some sense that we're using this as an imaginative exercise to think about what different futures could look like. You mentioned feminism. The feminist utopias are this wonderful subgenre that was totally neglected, that it is totally forgotten today. Our editor, Lyta Gold, is reading through a huge stack of these wonderful 19th century feminist utopian novels. They're all by women, and they're all imagining future societies in which gender roles have been eliminated or reversed, or women are in charge, or men wear dresses, or, you know, it's just minor variations, but these were dreams that people had back then, you know, things that, you know, elements of which have of course come to pass. And as you say, these things that seemed impossible once now seem very ordinary. The 8-hour workday, of course, the weekend, the elimination of child labor.
Absolutely. And you know, I mean, that utopian, I'm delighted. I've had Lyta Gold on the show. I'm delighted she's looking at that, because that utopian feminism existed in the 60s too. Shulamit Firestone and some other writers who were imagining a world where men were not necessary for reproduction and so on. I think it's great to imagine alternative possible futures. You mentioned prison, and I haven't read your essay on prison. You may mention this, but of course, prison itself in the modern sense, the modern penitentiary, is the result of a utopian impulse. First of all, the Quaker belief that people could sit in cells the way monks sit in cells and contemplate their wrongdoings and be penitent, hence the penitentiary. The fact that this sort of panopticon that Jeremy Bentham foresaw, you know, was also a progenitor of the prison where everybody's, where all the cells face out to a common area where they can be watched, right? So if prisons, if the utopian impulse can produce prisons, why can't it produce
the next
step beyond prisons?
Yeah.
Angela Davis in her writings about this, points out that the large majority of people in prisons today have either addiction problems or mental health problems. So if you treat the addiction and the mental health, you've already eliminated the majority of the need for prisons anyway.
Yeah, it's absolutely true. And we have places. There are towns, there are neighborhoods that have very low or almost non-existent crime rates. So you can look at examples of places where crime is all but non-existent. And that suggests that it's not a crazy idea to think that you can have a world that is both free of prisons, that treats these problems as social problems in need of treatment, as you say, and that also eliminates the causes of crime to the point where prison is just an unnecessary relic. I think it's absolutely the case. If you imagine being in a time where petty crimes were punished with torture and mutilation, it would seem inconceivable to dream of a world in which they weren't. But that world has come to pass. This is one area where I agree, actually, quite relatively strongly with Steven Pinker. You know, his whole thing in his new book, Enlightenment Now, is kind of castigating, getting upset with progressives for not appreciating progress. I think it's true that we have to appreciate how far we've come, because that should make us a little optimistic. Where I think he goes wrong is that he almost seems to think that it comes without you having to struggle and fight for it at every stage. And I think that's the part where we say, well, no, what we have to do in order to keep moving along that line is to say, well, what's next? Where do we go and how do we get it?
Well, and there's another problem with Steven Pinker, too. And Steven Pinker, of course, the author of books like Enlightenment Now, I think was the name of one of them, mm-hmm. Which is, you know, I picture Steven Pinker looking at a drowning child and saying, well, we don't have to help him. There were three kids drowning last week. You know, it's like, okay, the trend line may be improving in some sense, but there's a drowning kid out there. There are starving people in the world. There's poverty, there's inequality, there's poor health. And the notion that we should somehow be smugly content that it's not as extreme as it was, if we have the means to alleviate the suffering and we don't do it, it's just as immoral.
Current Affairs, we read a comic that got us some angry letters, which is called Steven Pinker Certified Grief Counselor, in which he shows up to people's funerals and goes, well, you should see the declining rates of violence and disease. And they're like, what? How is that any kind of comfort to me?
Well, so you were well ahead of me with the drowning child analogy. But I think that's, and again, and maybe we can sort of close with this, is that I think that the Steven Pinkers, the Sam Harrises, the Richard Dawkins, what they're really doing is they're speaking out of a world vision that isn't articulated, but the world vision is things are fine. The culture that we live in isn't really a culture at all, like goldfish don't think they're in water supposedly or whatever. In fact, your attempts to improve it are an insult to the world as it is, which is the world as it should be, and that the utopian impulse is, in fact, I live in Washington, D.C. If I didn't have utopian thoughts, I don't think I could bear to fight over the latest iteration of, you know, whatever benefit proposal is being put forward this week or whatever. Really, it's about creating an alternate vision of the world that energizes people to do something. Yeah. I don't know. I'll give you the last word.
Yeah, I think that's actually my core frustration is this kind of political quietism. There's, you know, what I've read a lot about in the book is their sort of vicious and unfair criticisms of the left, where they're distorting our ideas and such. But I think you're right that at its core, the bigger problem is that they're countenancing kind of doing nothing. Jordan Peterson does this explicitly. He says, basically, you know, take care of yourself, don't worry about the world. And it's odd because their theory of politics is very strange, because Peterson says he believes in equality of opportunity, but he never says what he believes you ought to do to make sure there is equality of opportunity. So there's a lot of criticism of the left for doing the wrong thing. But with Pinker, there's no theory as to, well, what should we do then? Let's be grateful for the progress we've made. I totally agree with you. But there's no vision, and not only is there no vision, but there's no practical plan and no practical thinking. And I think that's very dangerous to have. And I think ultimately you have to just sort of reject that. And this is why I think, this is why I think people should come and join the left. And this is what we have to offer people.
Yeah, and I think it's not just the Pinkers of the world and Petersons of the world. I think it's also, I'm going to make the argument anyway, that it's also the sort of the mainstream centrist Democratic Party view that says, well, if we just got rid of this crazy guy who's in the White House now and went back to the way it was, then the adults in the room would work it out. That to me is a kind of Pinkerism too. It's a kind of saying things were fine. No, things weren't fine. You know, inequality was soaring. The planet is being poisoned past the point of no return. How can you say things are fine? Whereas if we picture a world that's better, maybe people will actually do things like march in the streets, turn up to vote, work to make a better world.
Yeah, everyone, you know, for the Democratic Party, inequality and climate change, they've been problems, but they're just sort of things that you say. Nobody actually has an idea of how to readjust the balance of economic power to make less inequality. They all just lament inequality and they lament climate change. Well, you know, the point that we have to make is, well, you can't just lament it and tweak things. You have to come up with an idea of what you would adjust, and you have to be willing to fight because it's going to be really hard to fix it.
Yeah, and so by the way, you can't go Steven Pinker on that problem and say it's better than it was 100 years ago. It's markedly worse, both the climate and inequality. So in the last couple of minutes, how do we make it better?
Oh, gosh. How do we make it better?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the first thing is you need to have, I believe in this mixture of like big dreams and practical plans. And the practical plans part is, well, you need to run on policies that are actually going to materially improve people's lives in ways that they're going to see. I've written about candidates that I think do this well. I think Bernie Sanders does this well. I also think that Abdul El-Sayed did it really well in Michigan. He lost the primary, but he also came up with plans for how they were going to, he was going to introduce a state-level single-payer plan in Michigan and a state-level free college plan in Michigan. And those were really excellent ideas that would have changed people's lives. And I think that sort of thing, those policies are things that I think we need people on the left working out the tiny details of those plans. And they're not going to be the utopia, but they are going to be things that substantially get us closer to a world where people wake up and they don't have to worry about incredibly basic things like, am I going to be able to afford to, you know, my insulin, or am I going to be able to afford to, you know, enroll next semester?
All right. Well, I can't improve on that. So one foot in utopia and the other foot in the political fray, I guess, which sounds...
Yeah, sounds right.
All right. Okay, well, we'll have to leave it there. But Nathan J. Robinson, editor and publisher of Current Affairs and so much more. Always great to talk to you. Anything you want to plug before we go? Your website, currentaffairs.org.
Yeah. Go to currentaffairs.org, subscribe to our print magazine, which is beautiful, and we just sent a new issue off to the press, issue 14. So get that, get the books, and go to the podcast on Patreon and download all of those episodes, too.
All right, and I will be looking for my new issue in the mail. So Nathan J. Robinson, thanks for coming on the program.
Thanks, RJ. Nice to be with you.